Hi, let's talk about the abdominal aorta. The abdominal aorta is the part of the descending aorta that is inferior to the diaphragm. It runs posterior to the diaphragm. Sometimes we say through, but in actuality, it is posterior to the diaphragm at the level of about T12. And it terminates at about the level of L4 into the common iliac arteries. So as you may recall from our earlier discussions, there are visceral branches which may either be anteriorly oriented, such as the celiac trunk, which is about at the level of T12. So that celiac trunk on T12. The superior mesenteric artery, or the SMA, which is about the level of L1. And then there are renal arteries, and here is an accessory renal artery, also about the level of L1. We have gonadal arteries, that supply the gonads with blood, that are approximately at the level of L2. We have the IMA, or the inferior mesenteric artery, approximately at the level of L3. And we have some other minor arterial branches that we won't go into detail here on. And of course, parietal branches that are going to exit the abdominal aorta posterior laterally that we also won't discuss here. So let's take a look at the celiac trunk. Most people are rather surprised when they first see the celiac trunk, because typically there isn't much of a trunk to it at all, but rather three immediate branches that sort of blossom from the T12 level of the abdominal aorta. And here we can see there are the crura of the diaphragm. So let's take a look at these branches. So this first branch is the splenic artery. The splenic artery is a rather impressive, tortuous artery that's going to run posterior to the stomach. Oftentimes it can be found, you know, in close association with the pancreas. Here's the pancreas, and that continues on posterior to the stomach here. And it's heading out to its namesake, the spleen. That splenic artery will not only supply the spleen with blood, it will also supply the fundus of the stomach with blood through short gastric arteries. And it will supply, in part, the greater curvature of the stomach, which is this element here, with blood through the left gastro-omental artery. So this is the left gastro-omental artery, which we can see here, which also supplies the greater omentum with blood. The next branch of the celiac is the left gastric. This left gastric heads for the lesser curvature of the stomach to supply it with blood. And then we have the common hepatic artery. The common hepatic artery has two terminal branches. There's the gastroduodenal artery and the hepatic artery proper. That hepatic artery proper will typically give off the right gastric artery. That right gastric artery heads towards the lesser curvature of the stomach to anastomose with the left gastric artery. And then we have the bifurcation into the left and right hepatic branches, and typically off one of those, or off of the hepatic artery proper, a branch to the gallbladder as well. The gastroduodenal artery descends down inferiorly there, and it will send off the right gastroduodenal artery. So the right gastroduodenal artery meets up with the left gastroduodenal artery, and there's an anastomosis there for the greater curvature of the stomach. So the gastroduodenal arteries supply the greater curvature of the stomach. The gastric arteries supply the lesser curvature of the stomach. And then there are pancreatico-duodenal arteries that supply the head of the pancreas and duodenum with blood. The next major visceral branch is the superior mesenteric artery. That superior mesenteric artery will have an inferior pancreatico-duodenal branch that anastomoses with the pancreatico-duodenal branches from the gastroduodenal artery of the common hepatic artery from the celiac trunk. So that represents an anastomosis between SMA and celiac. And then in terms of the SMA, we'll have intestinal branches coming off of the main trunk of the SMA here. So branches to the jejunum and the ileum, and these have been cut here because that portion of the gut tube has been removed. And then we have various colic branches. So we'll have a middle colic branch going up to serve the transverse colon. We'll have a right colic branch going out to serve the ascending colon. And then we'll have an ileocolic branch going down to serve portions of the ascending colon, the cecum, the ileocecal valve, and portions of the terminal ileum. Now, all of these colic branches, middle, right, and ileocolic, don't directly vascularize the gut tube, but rather they connect with an artery known as the marginal artery that rides along the margin of the colon that I've just outlined. Now, what's interesting is that the inferior mesenteric artery has several branches, among them the left colic artery, which feeds directly into the marginal artery. So that marginal artery, it's of the superior mesenteric artery, but it is a significant anastomosis between the SMA and the IMA. The remaining branches of the inferior mesenteric artery include the sigmoid arteries, which supply the sigmoid colon with blood, and the superior rectal artery, which supplies the rectum with blood. Finally, we can see the gonadal arteries, which supply the gonads with blood, as direct branches of the abdominal aorta, and we can see them descending down into the abdominal cavity there. We can also see the relationship between the SMA and the left renal vein, which crosses the abdominal aorta there. Here's the IMA again, and then here is that bifurcation of the abdominal aorta into the common iliac arteries, which is approximately at the level of L4. And we'll see how those common iliac arteries divide into the external iliac and the internal iliac arteries as we discuss the arteries of the pelvis and the lower limb. Thank you very much for your time.